Our gospel text for this morning is a marvelous text filled with great joy and a note of somber. Our Lord Christ sends out 72 disciples to go before him and prepare the way, preaching the gospel. Peace be to this house, the kingdom of God has come near to you. Of course, the kingdom of God that is approaching is none other than Christ himself, who is the heavenly king seen by the prophet Isaiah, enthroned in glory and surrounded by angel hosts, singing, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." For those who accept this message of peace, it is truly a blessed message. Peace be to this home. This greeting is not a mere courtesy like saying good morning, nor is it a pious greeting. It's not a holy howdy, but it is a proclamation of the gospel. It is the same proclamation that you hear when pastor says, "The peace of the Lord be with you," while holding Christ's very body and blood in his hands during the Eucharist. It is a declaration that the war and enmity between God and man is over, and that God has come for reconciliation. And he himself will pay the war debt, not with cash, but with his holy, precious blood. Yet there is also a note of law. For those who reject the gospel proclamation and reject the messengers who carry it, they reject the king's free gift of grace. They spit on the peace delivered and worked through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. It will be more bearable in the judgment for Tyre and Sidon than for them. For those of you who were in Bible study this morning, you will notice that this message bears all the hallmarks of Christian preaching. It is a call to believe in Jesus Christ, in whom there is no condemnation. And it is the preaching of the law who reject this message. All who do not board the ark of the church, which has been built by the wood of the cross, will be swept away in the judgment like those who did not hear the preaching of Noah. In the name of Jesus, who is the ark of our salvation, amen. Now, when we read Scripture, it is always a good principle to look at who Jesus or the Scriptures are talking to and in what context. We do not want to misapply a verse to ourselves that does not directly apply to us. Truly, all Scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness. But not every command that the Lord gives is given directly to you. I hope you don't read the command given to the prophet Ezekiel, "You shall eat it as a barley cake, baking it in their sight on human dung," and immediately go out to Decatur, bake a piece of bread on Main Street on human feces and eat it. I hope you don't do that. That command was given to Ezekiel at a specific time for a specific purpose, which we're not going to go into now because we don't have time, but perhaps you can greet Pastor when he comes back with 50 questions about why God commanded Ezekiel to eat bread baked on human poop. So with this text, we should note that Jesus' commission in this text specifically is given to the 72, and it begins at verse 1 and ends at verse 17. Yet Jesus' commission of the 72 mirrors very closely the commissions given to the apostles in John 20 and Matthew 28. And so I think we should meditate on this text in that light. That is, in the light of Christ's ministry given to the apostles, which continues in the church today through the office of the Holy Ministry. So when Pastor gets back, you can also tell him that I laid out his job description for all you guys, and you're going to be checking to see if he's doing it. Or perhaps you shouldn't do that, because if you did, he might never invite me back to fill in for him. Okay, so we will address three topics. We will address whose ministry is it, what is the message of this ministry, and what is the purpose and effect of this ministry. So to our first point, whose ministry is it? It's not Pastor Patterson's ministry, it's not my ministry, and it's not the ministry of the 72. It is Christ's ministry. Christ does not send the 72 out to deliver whatever message they think the people need to hear, or to share their own wisdom about God, life, and morals. Indeed, he tells them exactly what they are to preach. Peace be to this house. The kingdom of God has come near to you. And to those who do not listen, I tell you, it will be more bearable on the day of judgment for Sodom than for this town. The 72 don't heal the sick by their own power. They don't speak on their own authority. They heal and speak by Christ's authority alone. It is his word and his power working through them as his agents. As a corollary to that, the 72 don't choose to become ministers of Christ, but he commissions them and sends them out, as Jesus says. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. God alone is the Lord of the harvest, and he alone can send workers into his field. The same goes for the apostolic ministry, which is continued in the church today through the office of the holy ministry. Christ commissioned his apostles, saying, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld." Christ sends his apostles and gives them the message they are to preach. They are to preach the gospel of the reconciliation and peace with God in the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And they are to preach law to those who do not repent. So too, he gives the apostles their marching orders, saying, "All authority in heaven on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you." All authority is Christ's authority. And on that authority, he sends his apostles out to make disciples by baptizing them in the name of the one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and by teaching them. In both these commands, it is important to note whom Jesus is speaking to. He's speaking to the apostles. Not all are sent, and not all are chosen for the ministry. As the apostle Paul says, "He gave some to be apostles, prophets, evangelists, shepherds, and teachers. Let no one make you feel guilty or that you are less of a Christian because you are here in Ohio raising a family, earning a paycheck, and growing food for the nation instead of heading out to Cambodia to preach the gospel." It is a horrendous lie of the devil to say that striving to live a godly life and receiving Christ's ministry of forgiveness in your local congregation is not enough. If all Christians are sent, then the salvation that comes through faith in Jesus Christ cannot be for all people. Someone needs to grow the food, to build homes and raise families. It is the Lord who sends ministers into the harvest, and he still does it today immediately through the church. He sends pastors into the field to proclaim the gospel and tend to his flock. Pastor Patterson has been placed here by the Holy Spirit to speak with Christ's authority to pronounce the forgiveness of your sins in this time and at this place. Now let me be clear, I am not negating the priesthood of all believers. We are all called to proclaim the excellencies of him who called us out of darkness into his marvelous light to our neighbors. Yet for the good of his church, God instituted the office of the holy ministry to baptize, to preach, to publicly proclaim the gospel, and to administer the Lord's Supper. This leads us to our second point. What is the message God sends these men to preach? The message of the 72 and the message of all Christian preaching is the same preaching. It is the preaching of law and gospel. All pastors are called to preach the law of God, that all sinful mankind is under the judgment of God and we have no hope of saving ourselves. And all pastors are called to proclaim the gospel, which is the message of peace with God and the forgiveness of sins won for us by the cross of Jesus Christ. And remember, this message is not their own message or their own words, but it is the message given to them by the Lord Jesus. When a pastor carries out the ministry of Christ according to his word and according to his institution, it is Christ himself who speaks and Christ himself who acts. When a pastor speaks the absolution, it should be believed because it is Christ himself who pronounces the forgiveness of sins. When a pastor baptizes, it is the triune God himself who is baptizing you and making you his children. And when a pastor delivers the Lord's Supper, administers the sacrament, it is Christ himself who is the host, giving himself in his body and blood for you to eat and to drink. Yet, when a pastor speaks any word that is not the word of God, he speaks with no more authority than any other human being. And that is why it is important for you, dear Christians, to read your Bible and know your scriptures, so that you can be discerning hearers. The entirety of the message given to the office of the holy ministry is directed towards Christ's gospel ministry. The law is preached to turn sinners away from themselves and turn them away from any hope of self-justification. And the gospel is the proclamation of God's reconciliation with the world in Jesus Christ. And thus, it is important for us to heed this message and make sure we do not reject it, as Christ warns. The one who hears you hears me, and the one who rejects you rejects me. The one who rejects me rejects him who sent me. Those who reject the pastor and his message of the gospel reject Christ who sent him, and in so doing, they reject God the Father as well. There is no peace with God outside of the gospel ministry of Christ that is continually worked through his holy church. If the message of the ministry is the gospel, and peace with God is the message, what then is the effect of this ministry? This ministry gives precisely what it preaches: peace with God, life everlasting, and forgiveness of sins. Jesus says, "I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven, and rejoice that your names are written in heaven." When the word of God goes out and is proclaimed, the power of the devil is broken. The devil is the great accuser who stands before the throne of God day and night accusing his saints. But those of you who are in Christ Jesus have no accusation against you because you are clothed with his righteousness. When the devil accuses you of sin, you may say, "Yes, dear devil, I am a sinner, but I am clothed with the righteousness of Christ." If you wish to accuse me, take it up with Jesus, because he says I am innocent. Through the preaching of this gospel, the power of sin, death, and the devil are broken. Your names are written in heaven and in the books of life, in the book of life. So rejoice. You are freed from domination and the dominion of the devil, and you belong to Christ Jesus. For his work of salvation on the cross, and for his continued ministry in the church, let us give him thanks and praise. Amen.